touch, 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 so that in the moment that they think about it, you were not that far from their mind. Is this so complicated?
No.
Well, it must be. It must be. It must be rocket science. It must be either that or I'm the worst communicator on the planet, which is quite possible.
I think one thing that would help them is, let's define a database. A database is not Outlook, it's not your iPhone, right? It's probably not even Gmail. You've got to be able to segment it into groups. Who are my advocates, who are my meds, admins, whatever you've done, and you've got to be able to put them on plans.
Yes.
It's that simple. Can you segment it and put them on plans?
It is that simple. I remember having a real estate agent in my office years ago. This is back in the, would have been in the early 90s. And we were talking about database, and this gentleman didn't have one. I said, that's nuts. Come over to my computer. I said, here, let's call my database. Let's pick a segment. Let's target people in this area. Boom, we created the list. I said, okay, now let's send them a note real quick. So let's go to my letters and choose one. Well, let's choose that. Okay, let's customize it real quick. Okay, let's hit print. Let's go to lunch. When we came back, the letters were all sitting there. I said, this is it, dadgummit. This is it. It's that simple. I'm now touching these people in a meaningful way with a personalized message. Why don't you do that? Right? Of course, the good news for me as a business person is, outside this room, I hope nobody gets it. Right? And I'm certain they won't. So I'm totally safe in telling people. Because they won't do it. I know they won't do it. Right? It's not going to happen. I'm not going to build the relationships. Okay? Mistake number four, they don't make lead generation their one thing. Duh. They don't time block. What we see is we don't see time block, right? If there's one thing you could do as a business person that someone in your business has to do, is you have to do this. You have to do it until it feels weird not doing it. Makes sense? Right? What did we hear Kevin yesterday said that he went out and went off in Travis Heights? Dude, that's a very good man from California.
Right.
And he said, yeah, Travis Heights is an area in Austin, Texas. And I'm going, dude, okay, that's not stupid, really. That could be stupid. Or it could be weird, right? But at the end of the day, I get exactly what, backstage, he was saying, hey, this is what I do. We got to stay in that mode. This is it. This is my livelihood.
It's 50 doors a day for him, right? 50 doors a day. It's 50 doors a day for
him. That's what he said. Yeah. It should feel weird if you don't do it. Right? It's like that ad that the commercial for, is it F?
Okay, it's F. I have no idea where you're going.
Well, when a guy knocks on the door of the apartment or the house and he sold it, but he comes back in and sits down on the couch because it'd be weird if it didn't work. Right? Superstition in sports.
Oh, that one, yes. I got
it. Yeah, the point is that, yeah, we're just having a moment, sorry. No, it should feel weird, just like with exercise or anything else. It should feel weird if you're not lead generating. And by the way, if it doesn't feel weird right now that you're not lead generating at this moment on a Friday, that means you haven't built in the habit. And there is the alarm button that should be going off in your head. Because you're sitting here relaxing, not even worried about the fact that you didn't do it. Some of you are fidgeting, and it's weird, and you're ticked that we don't do mega camp starting at noon till 8 o'clock, because that would make more sense. Instead, we start here, and we violate exactly what we're talking about. No, it's just a violation. And trust me, it feels weird. On days like this, I don't exercise, I'm not regenerating, I'm not writing. It feels weird to me. This feels like cheating to me. This feels totally weird. I'm not totally comfortable in my skin on days like this. Because at 58, who am I? I'm an individual that exercises, eats, writes, and lead generates my life. And these are the things that drive my life. I'm not perfect at it, but here's the good news. I don't have to be perfect. If I do it, I'm going to beat 99% of the rest of the population, even if I suck at it. See, people, I read all the time about the things that Gary Keller does wrong and all these other things, and I go, look, I get it. I really do. I get it. I understand that. Fight. I mean, I understand that. I do. No, I do. I got it. I understand it. And if it's a moral issue or an ethical issue or whatever, you're right to deem me. Otherwise, pay attention. I don't care. I don't care because success doesn't come from doing it right all the time. It comes from always doing it.
That's right.
okay? And since I understand that better than you, kiss my butt. If you're my competitor, good luck. Okay, because I'm going to stop until I die. Okay, don't bury me, and then I will get him in the binding, so I'm going with me, we'll see what happens. Let me know, all right? So 3 to 4 hours. It's not an hour, it's not 30 minutes, it's 3 to 4 hours. Get your butt in gear and do it. And make that your job description. Someone says to you, what do? You say, I'm a professional business person who lead generates 3 to 4 hours a day. I happen to be in real estate. Most of you say, what do? You say, I'm in real estate. I don't even know what that means. You're in real estate? I know you're standing on it, but you're sitting on it. We mean you're in real estate. I don't know what that means. Okay? That can have a wide variety of meanings. But if you tell me I'm a lead generator for 3 to 4 hours a day as a business person who happens to sell real estate, I know what that means. I know exactly where your head is, right? The second thing is you gotta learn the language of sales, right? Which means you better learn what and practice what.
Scripts and dialogues every day.
Oh my gosh, understand, this is an industry of information and decision making. So number one, you've got to have the information. By the way, the internet will continue to challenge you to have more information and have a better understanding of it. Over time, analytics does a pretty good job, right? It does what the store, the grocery store, or the corner bookstore should have done but didn't do. When I walk in, they didn't recognize me, even though I've bought 50 books from them, right? When you think about Barnes & Noble, I used to stop there a minimum of once a week and buy a book, Jay.
You should have had stock. I mean, you were always in there.
Yeah, I ain't letting you. Yeah, I mean, you know? And no one ever recognized me. No one ever said, hi, Gary, good to see you back. But I'll be dead good if Amazon doesn't say, hi, Gary, good to see you back. How did you like the book that you read? By the way, people that read that book read these other books. And oh, by the way, let's give you order of all the books that are off the road in case you want to go back and read the other ones. It's informing me better than the dadgum live person. So guess what? The Amazon is my better friend and a better servant to me than you are. Now, you can beat it if you want, but if not, they're going to beat you. Because, see, they don't have a choice. Program, they do it automatically every second of every day. They never fail to say hi, Gary. They never fail to say hi, Gary. They never fail to say hi, Gary. They never hi. They never fail to say it. Okay? So at the end of the day, learn scripts and dialogues, learn the information, and then learn how to convey it in a way that helps people make decisions. Okay? And that means you're going to have to practice it. You're going to have to practice it every day. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, find a peer partner and practice it. Right? The last thing is you've got to track your sources. When you lead generate, you have to know what worked or didn't work. It's very simple. Okay? What's great is when you can get successful enough that you can spend a few dollars, even if it's like I did initially, it's just someone who works 2 hours a day for you, part-time, minimum wage, and they track it. Your goal is to get successful enough to hire someone to do the things you hate to do, but you did anyway. Okay? And one of them is track. Mistake number five, you don't focus on listings. It's leads to generate listings. It's leads to generate listings. Why? Because listings are our product. If you don't control the product and the pricing of the product and the market, and bringing that product to the market, who are you? You're truly a middleman. If you're not the manufacturer or the person who produces the product and brings it to the market, who are you? Who are you? And this is the whole issue. When we talk about hurdles and all of this, these are not evil warlords. But let me tell you, just like Barnes & Noble got Amazon and Blockbuster got Netflix, I'm telling you right now that if you're not careful, you and your MLS are going to unwittingly give away the thing that gives you the control of your business, and that is the manufacturing of the product, the creation of the product, and then putting it out there in some sort of an environment. Right, we call it co-opetition, we call it MLS. But many of our MLSs overstep their boundaries by thinking that their job is then to go do additional things for you. Yes, if they do it in alignment with what works for them, right? So simply hold your lead generation accountable and do what?
Get listings. And it just doesn't happen naturally, right? Buyers seem to show up. And if you talk to anyone who isn't focused on this, they have a buyer-heavy business.
We did.
So you have to wake up one day and say, if I don't really focus in, hold it accountable. What language is important? It's just not going to happen organically. You got to manufacture it.
No, and one of the biggest reasons why when people are buying a house, they tell everybody when they're selling their home, yeah.
They're kind of private about it.
They're more silent sellers. They don't run down the street and say, hey, I'm selling their home. Okay? But when they're buying, it's a joyous occasion. When they're selling, it may or may not be. So they're not as open about it, and thus it doesn't happen naturally that we find out as much about that. So if you don't purposely go up for listings, you naturally have more buyers.
Right.
And this is a fact. It's not our opinion. This is a fact. This is the way it is. Look at your own businesses. You'll see it's true. So if you don't purposely go after listings, which means you have a short list of activities, what happens is we look at the activities and go, I want to do that, 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 but I want listings. In order to get listings, you'll have to do that or that or that or that or that.
Okay. I think it was Rich yesterday, he said, there's kind of pending in my advertising and marketing that doesn't go directly towards listings. That's the only thing it generates for.
Well, by the way, isn't that what the portals want? So they kind of understand it better than you. They're not advertising buyers. What are they advertising? So you understand that portals are listing agents. Right now, you're the middleman between them and getting them. Tomorrow, you may not be the middleman between getting them. If you keep behaving the way you do, you won't be. You get that? So they understand they went right after the listings. That's the biggest mistake that you see the real estate agents make is they don't go for the listing. The smart one goes for the listing. I will assure you, look at the individuals that come up on the stages over the years, and we listen to how they're building big businesses to a person, they're ultimately going to have to get the listing, or they're going to hit ceilings way below their potential. Okay? And then the trick there is focus on a minimum number of appointments, and we saw that yesterday. Why?
Right.
If you went out and
13 appointments a week, you're a millionaire.
I love it.
Keeps it simple.
It's simple. Simple to say, not easy to do. But again, if you boil it down to just some simple truths and make sure that your action just make that happen, that's the simplicity we want. Okay? Mistake number six, don't stick to a plan. Most agents avoid, they don't avoid the shiny objects, right? And even coming to an event like this can be a disaster for some people. And the reason is because they don't have a business plan to begin with. If you had a business plan and you show up at a meeting like this, you should have the business plan in front of you or in your mind, and you're listening to try to figure out how to improve your business plan and your actions based on what you're hearing. But a lot of people don't have, it's like having a Christmas tree and ideas or ornaments. What happens is they have no Christmas tree. So when they come here to see all the shiny ornaments, they just start grabbing them and just throw them into their business with no organized way of using the ideas. This is why the business plan is important. It actually is going to keep you from going after the shiny objects, right? And the other issue, and Jay and I say this constantly, is you have to what? Make peace with what?
Boredom and mastery, right? You just kind of do it again and again. When we were putting this together, I told you I thought about Warren Buffett that stopped and read The Intelligent Investor 12 times in a row. There's just no way that was exciting. There was just nothing that could be good about that experience.
Reading that book once is painful.
It's huge. It's wow. Yeah. But he knew it was necessary, and he committed to doing it, and he's the wealthiest man on earth.
Thank you very much. Yeah. You have to make peace with the boredom of mastery. And the reason why it's boring is because it's repetitive. It's boring because it's repetitive. And you have to make peace with that. You have to make peace with that. I thought it was interesting, you know, when we wrote the one thing, and it was the manuscript stage, my wife read it. And our son had headed off to college, and she goes, you know, I don't have my one thing anymore. And so she took her pain, right? So she's now been at it, right? And she, I wish I had a picture of, she's actually getting daggum good. It's actually awesome. But here's the thing is, at first, the ESA was over here, and then she migrated into it every now and then. Then she put it in the laundry room, which is right at the kitchen, and then she started doing it a little more. Our dining room is now Our breakfast table has been shoved aside. She has two easels going. She's got her computer there with the paintings that she's doing. She's got her art books. We don't have a dining room anymore. Because what she's done is she has made peace with the boredom of the activity, and she has stuck it in a place where she cannot run from it.
But people, they quit too soon. But when they get through that initial boredom, there's real joy on that path and peace.
Oh my God.
You show up and you start noticing the little improvements that most people will never appreciate. And we study that a lot in the one thing, how Michael Phelps would like work just for weeks on like his hand motion in the water, and most people would never even appreciate it. And there was joy in that journey, but most people don't ever get to that point. And it's not as far away as they think.
Now, the truth of the matter is, if you can describe what he just did, I'm getting bored listening to you. I mean, immediately thinking, that's so painful that if that's the way it is, I just may kill myself now. You know, I'm just going.
Let's give up our competitive swimming careers then. Let's just set that aside.
Yeah, I'm just teasing. But I'm saying, but then I laugh and go, but that is the issue of when you describe mastery, the path of mastery.
Yeah.
And this happens, you know, I tell people constantly, I tell my son this, I said, I was about ready to hate myself like I most said I hated it so much. I hated it. I've got a degree and so I wasn't qualified to do anything else. But I hated it. It was so boring. It's horrible. And I'm out there talking to people with kids. I mean, I'm 22 years old. You know? And I'm driving by a hot Volkswagen Beetle that's painted yellow, you know, and with no air conditioning, by the way. Yeah, no air conditioning. And I'm going, oh my gosh, you know, I hate this. Knocking on doors, I'm pulling open house, man, I'm calling on FISBOs. I did go out on a date with my first expired person. Which is a true story, by the way. And my wife and I joined, we were in a membership group when we joined a church. Look across the room, and there was my former expired listing attorney, David. She married a good-looking attorney, so she's done a lot better. She came over. It's funny because they came over, and he recognized me too. I don't know how he did that, but anyway.
It's an interesting twist on cold call.
Yeah. I didn't keep her in my database, just so you know. It's a whole other set of skills, and I can't emphasize that enough. It's a humbling set of new skills. So if you thought that learning to be a real estate salesperson is successful at certain levels hard, this is equally hard. It's not easier. I wouldn't say it's any harder, but it's equally hard, and it deserves every bit as much time. So the problem is, for a period of time in your life, you're kind of messed up because you now have two one things. That's why it says leads to listings, leads to leverage. It becomes two one things. And you're going to have to master both, right? So number one is you got to make a stand on your first hire. Now you heard that yesterday a lot. But that's the trick, is you've got to make that stand. What we find fascinating is that people equate speed with success. Right? Be very careful about this. But just because you hired someone quickly doesn't mean you hired correctly. Okay? The number one secret I can give you for hiring is have a defense. Go find a person or a couple of people and vow that you will never hire another person without having to defend them to someone else. Because I will tell you something. Most of you are cheaters. In fact, I'll go as far as say is we're all cheaters. We naturally want to cheat, which means we want to cut the butter, which means instead of rounding the corner, we just cut the grass. We just go right across the grass to get what we want. So when you think you see someone, you go with your gut, which is the acronym for give up thinking. Right? So we go with our gut. And I hear people constantly bragging about their gut. I have a good gut, I have a good gut. And in my head, I'm going, yeah, you don't think. Not only that, you don't want to be held accountable, but that's why you go with your gut. Because when you brag with your gut and say, hey, it's all about my gut, hey, you don't have to think. Number two, you don't have to follow any rules because you're a genius. Okay? You're a genius. Let me tell you right now, you need to make a stand and master right there. And that's going to slow you down at first. In other words, everyone's going to be passing you by, but you're going to be stuck in your one location doing your one thing there for how many years? take you a while, okay? But that's okay. Because once you master that and get that individual, you watch what happens. You will speed up. And remember, this is your journey. A lot of times we sit in this room and we compare the speed at which we're going to other people. I will assure you on your deathbed, that will not be your issue. Don't make it your issue now. Your speed is your speed. This is about you. It's not about you compared to others. Your journey is your journey. However long it takes is how long it takes. Okay? Don't abandon it because for some reason you think you're going slower than you should. If you're going slower, ask why. And one of the reasons on hiring you were going slower is you didn't take the recruit select class 20 times. You took it once or twice and thought you got it. And I'm telling you right now, when you take that class, that's during the first grade. Second time is the second grade. And I want you to get a college degree in hiring. And that means you got to take it over and over and over again. At some point, you should be teaching it. Right? By the way, number two, hold everyone accountable. Use a 411. The biggest challenge you have is you're trying to learn to manage people. I hate managing people. In fact, people will tell you I don't. What I do is I manage expectations because I can do that. So I don't get into it because people say, and they didn't find me because I say it a lot. They say, don't be John Maxwell. It's not true. I love John Maxwell. In fact, John Maxwell's a genius. And he doesn't write anything that isn't awesome. The problem is I'm not John Maxwell, and I can't read Maxwell and implement Maxwell. That was my big aha with Tom Hopkins. Tom Hopkins is an amazing salesperson. But when you read his material, I went, I'm not Tom Hopkins. I can't do Tom Hopkins the way Tom Hopkins teaches it, because I don't have that personality. Right? When a guy tells you put on a band uniform and knock door, you realize real quickly, you may not be Tom Hopkins, okay? Don't struggle with that. But where I made peace with it, and a lot of you may have the same issue, is I just learned to manage expectations. And I use a 411 as a tool. People say, well, can I use anything? Sure you can. The reason why you should use this one is because it's the same thing someone else in your organization is using. And by the way, the organization teaches and reinforces it. So over time, it becomes a cultural thing. If you invent your own thing, then you're an island to yourself. You have no support around you. Because a lot of people say, well, what's so smart about that? I go, it's not that smart. But if we just agree that it's smart enough, I have someone say, well, I have something better. I say, you don't have something better. Accountability is better by itself. So don't tell me you created a better form. There's no better form. There's no worse form either, for all that matter. It's a form. It holds you accountable. You manage expectations. You have a nice life.
And use it yourself.
And I have people walk in and go, but I use this and we use this and it's better. So be careful. If you're using the word better, you're an idiot. Because you don't understand what managing expectations is about. There is no better. You got something different. You like it. That's awesome. And that's beautiful. Here's the dilemma. You're an island. And what we see in our own organization is when someone goes that route inside our company, and I mean in your business and inside your own team, the next thing they do is they're using a different coach and a different trainer. And the next thing you know, they're off the island and you've let them escape. Do you hear that? And I run into this all the time. I run into this all the time. I'm working with a top agent, and one of their biggest struggles internally is turnover and people and things like that, and holding them accountable. And then you look at what they're doing, and they're using Covey, and they're using Fairy, and all these other things. And you're going, look, these are great trainers, but at the end of the day, you should come back and use homogenized systems that is supported everywhere around you. Because this is what's going to reinforce it, so your own people will be reinforced when you're not there using something different. They don't have any place to go except to leave your organization to learn about it. And by the way, you have unwittingly invited your own people out the door. Do you understand that? And we see it all day long. Now we see it all day long. We see it all day long. And we're going, look, we're not trying to be the smartest. We're not trying. No one said it was the best. We're saying is it does its job. Use it. Use it for that reason. It's the only reason we would say use it. Otherwise, everybody do your own thing. You know? Build a bench. Meaning that the second you hire somebody, when they go to hire someone, hold them accountable to hire a replacement. Hold them accountable to hire a replacement. The Because if you don't, what's happened is you haven't built a
bench.
Yeah. Which means you're one person leaving to get the job back. If you build a bench, then you're two people leaving to get the job back. Now you have a little job security.
For good or bad reasons. If you promote them, you get the job back.
Yes.
Right? It could be they leave or you promote them. You still got a vacancy that you didn't have to have.
So it's only when your organization is two people leave that you're not in jeopardy. When it's one person leave, and they